ओम अम्मा, नो द बेसिक्स ऑफ सनातन धर्म। टुडेज टॉपिक, व्हाट इज द इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ साउंड इन वेदास। वेदास पार्ट 5, एपिसोड 41 बाय चंद्रशेखर जे। डियर फ्रेंड्स, द साउंड कंसिस्ट ऑफ टू एस्पेक्ट्स। वन इज नादम, अनदर इज पदम। नादम मीन्स द टोन, द वाइब्रेशंस of sound energy, and padam means the words. Dear friends, in nadam it is a continuous sound wave, no letters, no meaning, but can be of varied tone and their varied expressions. Whole of cosmos is filled with nada shakti, or vibrations of the sound. The musical instruments, flute, veena, tabla, and various other instruments produce this nada shakti. When we come to padam, the words, the sound becomes letters, the letters become words, and words become sentences, and sentences become knowledge repositories and literature. This is how the speech, the human speech, one is the tunes and another is the nadam, the vibrations, and another is words, dear friends. Now let us study the impact of sound and vibrations. Some sounds make us joyful. Some sounds irritates us. Some sounds energize us. Some sounds make us dull. Dear friends, army stops doing marching on the bridge because the rhythmic march creates a resonance effect which may break the bridge. In the synergy of energy of the sound, there is power, there is charm, there is rhythm, and there is energy associated with it. Now friends, every sound is accompanied by vibrations, and vibrations are full of energy. Conversely, to create certain kind of vibrations, our rishis have found out certain sounds. They are mantras. Each mantra, when recited repeatedly with a certain frequency and with faith, it creates a form of divine aspect called as devata. Our rishis have perceived the forms of devatas transcending their senses, hence they are called as mantra drashtas. Hence Vedas are called as shrutis, and to be heard when chanted, and lot of care and importance is given for utterance of Veda mantra. Friends, how can mantras, the mere sounds, create the form of devatas? By increasing the frequency of repetitions of mantra, that is mantra japa, the intense vibrations of particular aspect of the divinity is invoked and visualized. Mind will be in an exalted state of vibrations to perceive them. For example, according to the variations in chanting, there are various Ganesha forms, there are various Saraswati forms, there are various Devi forms also different. Now let us draw the parallel with the modern day ultrasound transducer. In the transducer, which sends out the inaudible high frequency sound waves into the body and listens for returning of the echoes, this ultrasound image is based on the loudness, the amplitude, pitch, and the time it takes for the ultrasound signal to return to the transducer. Friends, we all see the ultrasound images based on the computer does this, and based on the echo returns from the object, especially it takes the amplitude, the loudness, the pitch, and the timing, and all these things, and constructs an image. And the image is formed. The same principles apply to the sonar used by boats and submarines and even bats also, dear friends. So similarly, for this reason, same reason, Vedic mantras give the top priority to amplitude, that is loudness, timing, pitch, and pronunciation. Now let us look into this. Our rishis observed the synergy between the breath and sound vibrations in the body. The life energy in the body is prana shakti. The sound vibrations in the body is nada shakti. When they come together, it becomes the akshara dvani. The akshara dvani becomes has become the Rig Veda, the hymns, and from there the mantra shastra evolved. Akshara dvani again became Samaveda, and it became Sangeeta shastra. Dear friends, each akshara is considered as devata, and each raga is considered as divine. Dear friends, now let us analyze the process of speech given by our rishis. They have divided the evolution of speech into four stages. First stage is called as paravaku. The second stage is called as pashyanti vaku. The third stage is called as madhyama vaku. And fourth stage is called as vaikari vaku. Dear friends, these are the four stages. Paravaku means the potential form of sound energy, that is silence. Pashyanti vaku means it is a sankalpa stage, a visualizing stage of thought or idea of sound energy. Now in bhavana stage, madhyama vaku comes, that is associating letters with a language, or with associating the sound with letters and language. And vaikari is expression stage, that is pronunciation, pitch, amplitude, timing, and the clarity of the speech. All these things form the vaikari vaku. Vaikari vaku is what we hear, which is a gross output. All these things happen internally. Vaikari happens externally. Friends, paravaku is like a seed of the tree. It is silence. It is pregnant with many sounds. It is potential. And in the pashyanti stage, the sprouting stage of a plant, it can be compared to the sprouting stage of the plant. And madhyama is like a tender plant. And in vaikari, it is a full grown tree, because already the speech happens. Friends, these are when it is our rishis have not only made this four concept, four stages of speech, they have related it with the breath, and they have associated with our shat chakras in the body in yogic terminology. Mooladhara chakra is the base of us, and there is called as paravaku. And Manipura chakra is called, and it is located in the navel region, it is called as pashyanti vaku. Madhyama vaku is anahata chakra, that is in the heart region. And Vishuddha chakra is our throat region. So this is how our yogic centers or shat chakras of the four chakras are related to our speech, dear friends. Now, if we want to say milk, so first paravaku is silent. So I want to say milk. A thought has come to me. So I should express I want milk. So this thought is common. You may be an American, you may be an Indian, you may be an African, you may be a Kannadiga, you may be a Telugu, you may be a Tamilian, or you may be a Marathi. All this thought is same for everybody. So at pashyanti level, you are making a thought. A thought is coming. You are visualizing what you want to express. So this is the pashyanti vaku. Most of the Mahatmas, they understand our thoughts. That's how they communicate. So this is, they do that at the pashyanti level. Or they, because the para level, they can transfer everything. So these are one of the advanced stages of communications. Now in the madhyama stage, madhyama vaku, what happens is that you start associating the thought with letters and with the language. So it happens here. Now I have to say milk. Milk is in English. Suppose if I have to say in Kannada, I have to say halu. Suppose I have to say in Hindi, I should say dood. If I have to say in Tamil, Telugu, or Malayalam, I should say palu. So like this, I should correlate the thought that I want milk to particular language and particular alphabets. Now, finally, I express as milk, dood, hala, halu, or palu, or like that. That is, I use certain kind of pitch, certain kind of loudness, certain kind of timing. All this gets involved. This is vaikari vaku. So this is how our process of speech has been evolved, dear friends. Now I'm telling you, all these alphabets, like they have been systematically designed from throat to the lips. There is a systematic evolution of the sounds if you really look at it. Now, ka ka ga ga nya, it comes, it is pronounced with the help of throat. That's why they are called as kanthavyas. Now, cha cha ja ja na, that is pronounced with the help of jaws. That's why talavyas. Then, ta ta da da na, with the help of the tongue hitting the roof. That is called as mrudanya. Then, with the help of teeth, they are called dantyas. Tha tha dha dha na. Then, with the help of lips, pa pa ba ba ma. So when we are saying pa pa ba ba ma, and see ka ka ga ga nya. So from here to here, systematically, all the alphabets, consonants have been arranged, dear friends. Now, dear friends, this is based on, this is how the Panini, a great grammarian in his Ashtadhyaya, has designed everything and which has become the grammar. Vyakarana, we'll be dealing with it. Now, sage Panini visualized the sounds of Damaru of Nataraja and given the alphabets in 14 sutras. They have become the 14 sutras. They are called as Maheshwara Sutra in the grammar difference. Now, in Mantra Japa, all these alphabets are used as mantras. Each mantra is used to invoke a particular aspect of divinity called as Vedas. The constant repetition of mantra is called Japa. Every mantra has a Bijakshara associated with it. For example, Gam Ganapatiye Namaha. Gam is the Bijakshara here. Shreem is the prosperity, that is Mahalakshmi Mantra. That is the Bijakshara of the Mahalakshmi Mantra. Aim is the Saraswati, Bijakshara of the Saraswati Mantra. Clean is the Kamaraja, desire, and it is the clean of the Kamaraja Mantra. So dear friends, every alphabet is made into a mantra and every mantra is associated with a Devata. So Bijaksharas are the seeds. Our body is the field and we water it through mantra japa and it becomes a wonderful tree of vibrations, divine vibrations, and it protects us. That's why it is called Marana Trayate Iti Mantraha. It protects us from the various ill effects or negative vibrations and makes our mind to function properly and to seek the divinity and go forward. This is how our sages have given us a wonderful knowledge system called as Mantra Shastra. Above all, Om is the powerful Bijakshara. That's why Om is always accompanied by the another Bijakshara and the mantra that follows. The hymn follows. So Om is the main Bijakshara and next is a particular Bijakshara and then the other aspect of the mantra. This is how the Mantra Shastra is evolved. A lot of things are there. When we really read Mantra Shastra, we should be able to go to a particular guru and learn the Mantra Shastras from the guru. If we learn it haphazardly, it instead of creating benefits, it will also create harm, dear friends. So this is how Mantra Japa is there. In the next episode, we will discuss how Vedas are chanted and methods of chanting. Om Lokaha Samastaha Sukhino Bhavantu. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Arihi Om.